Thank you, Dr. Hackett, very appreciative. And thank you for our brothers and sisters, young and otherwise, just across, we'll call it the larger pond as well. So it's really good to be in your presence. I'm thankful to the Golden Aya for promoting this, for being a partner in this, and I'm just really happy. So I won't really be long with any comments. You'll see in the background, you probably can't see it, but it's a globe, and it has our college tagline of locally engaged and globally prepared. I'm actually sporting the same t-shirt right now of locally engaged and globally prepared. And that's really what we're trying to do with students, and also just engage our college and engage communities and prepare our students and also prepare the globe for leadership. That you all are participating in this, that means whether you're near or far, manifest what we're trying to do and what we actually are doing. So with that, I'm gonna turn it back over, and just I'm really glad to be in this space. I'm glad to be within this partnership. I'm glad to, it's all about connectivity. And so there's just a lot of happiness. So despite even on the East Coast, a lot of us may not be happy to be up at 5:30, but we're happy to be in partnership. We're happy to be in brotherhood and sisterhood and to be in family. And again, this is the beginning of something special. And just thank you for bringing us all together. Thanks,
Dr. Sisson. Thank you so much, Dean Searcy. I appreciate you welcoming us to this event. I would also like to have my colleague, Dr. Marquita Gamage, to say a few words. So thank you for blessing us this morning, Dr. Gamage. Please take it away.
Good morning and good afternoon. Thank you all and welcome from the Africana Studies Department here in California. We welcome you and we appreciate the opportunity to dialogue with you for one of the first of many to come in this cross-cultural exchange. We appreciate this opportunity to serve in this way and to generate great dialogue between our youth and our future scholars. Many of our students here are some of our brightest students who have worked with Dr. Hackett over the years. And so we really want to applaud them for the opportunity to join you all today and to share in this cross-cultural exchange. We want to also welcome and thank our additional speakers and readers today. And thank you for all the good folks at Golden Aya for gathering your students together today to join us. We're excited about this opportunity and what the opportunity holds for the future. And hopefully we'll see some of you here in the future here at CSUN. So welcome and thank you all again for joining us.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gamage. I really appreciate that warm welcome. I think we'll get started with a teach and greet, as we call it. Solomon and Izana and Maya said that their students would teach us a greeting in Swahili. And so let's go ahead and bring those folks aboard, and we'll add to the spotlight. Okay, take it away, Sullivan.
All right, hello, how you all doing? This is class one. Now I'm gonna have one of our students teach a word in Swahili. And now we're going to have someone from my second class also teach you a little bit more Swahili.
All right, that's great. That is fantastic, everyone. Now, one of the things I would like to do is turn it over to Solomon to talk about your creed of Golden Ayah.
We're actually going to have our students do the creed for you today, led by our teacher.
I am strengthened by those who have come before me.
Yes, I love that. Let's give them a round of applause. You guys are our future kings and queens. Great job. Great job. I wish somebody would sing the Black National Anthem here, but we'll just keep moving for now. We'll get more into that lesson later. I think now what we'll do is we'll turn it over. So we're going to do a STEM activity. And one of our students and teachers in the Antelope Valley District, Amor Jackson, she will be facilitating. And I will take it, Amor, take it away.
All right, good morning, everybody on the West Coast. All right, and hello, students. So let me go ahead and share my screen. It says the host disabled participant screen sharing.
You got it.
All right, and while I'm waiting for the screen sharing capability, my name is Amore Jackson. I am a middle school teacher in California. There we go. Let's see, there we go. Okay, let me start from the top. So my name is Amori Jackson. I'm a middle school teacher here in California. I'm also teach at the high school level at East Los Angeles College in the pharmacology department for students who want to be pharmacy technicians. So today we are going to do a paper tower activity. Let me put this in full screen so you can see it. And I do this activity with my students, and I actually have one of my students here to shed light on some of the things we do in the classroom. All right. So first, let's learn about science versus engineering. Okay, science is the portion that explains a phenomena. Phenomena means anything that occurs. For example, if you have a pencil and if you drop it, what is that phenomena? What is happening there? If you light a match and you see fire, what caused that fire to exist? That's the science. And that's when the scientists, they're engaged and they have their discussions to figure out the explanation of that phenomena, all right? Engineers. Engineers are the people who come together to fulfill a human need. For example, if you're unable to get from point A to point B, the engineers will come together to build something like a bridge. Okay, engineers, they design something that's gonna help us out. The cell phone. Engineers designed the cell phone in order for us to communicate faster. If you think back then we used paper and pencil and we wrote letters to each other, but we needed a faster way. And one thing about engineers, sometimes they don't create this crazy new invention. They can just simply develop a new invention to improve the model that we already have. Okay, so today you guys are going to be engineers. And through this process, you're going to build a paper tower with only a few items on hand. So you should have 10 pieces of paper. All right, in my classroom, we use recycled paper. So 10 pieces of paper, whatever type of paper that works, and 10 paper clips. Now, either you could do this activity individually or you could work together as a group and collaborate. All right, whatever your instructor wants you to do, that's up to you. And you must build a paper tower that is long as a meter stick. All right, so it must be as tall as a meter stick. And the requirement is it must stand on its own for longer than 30 seconds. Okay, so you really have to brainstorm. And with this whole idea, sometimes you have to work with limited supply. And while going through the engineering design process, you have to look at the different materials that you have on hand and see if that's gonna be suitable in order for you to build what you need to build. Remember, to fulfill the human need. I actually have one of my students here, Princess. She's a former student and she participated in this lab activity, okay? Let me go back. All right, Princess, can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. So based on the class, when you were in my class last year, what is something that stuck with you when we started learning about science versus engineering?
Something that stuck with me personally was the interesting facts that we learned about it when we were doing the projects and things. I've learned a lot about that, when especially with this assignment. It was hard to do in the beginning, but once we got the hang of it and we went to got a little bit more instructions about it, I've began to understand it more.
And then Princess, next question that I want to ask you to share with the students, engineering, how have you used this in your life? All right, because you've found a love for science, but how have you applied this continuing in your higher education?
Well, with me being in the medical and engineering program in high school, this has came a long way to help me, because we in high school, we have learned about this stuff that we learned in middle school. So it's kind of bringing back the same memories about what we learned. And I'm taking the science that we learned in middle school from your class into high school. And I've been getting my work done. I've been getting good grades and stuff just from this.
Awesome.
We want to talk real slow because they have to translate from English to Swahili. So, but keep going.
Okay. So let's go ahead and get started with the activity here. Do you all have supplies available with the 10 piece, the two pieces of paper and the 10 paper clips?
Yes, we do. Also, just to let everyone know, it's better to pause so we can have the time to translate so that we're not trying to listen and translate at the same time. Thank you.
I guess one part I can take this.
No problem. Sorry about that.
No problem. Just letting everyone know so you can translate. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. Also, so the supplies that we do have are paper clips and they're like large papers. We don't have the real sticks, so we said that we'll just have them try to see the power that they can and allow them to stand up with the baby sticks.
Okay. Awesome. And you know what? Not having the meter stick just adds more to the design process. All right. So again, working with limited supply. Sometimes you have to improvise as an engineer. So Solomon, whenever you're ready, however you're going to group your students, to participate in the STEM lab. I can see the students on my end.
Okay, we're gonna break them into groups and we're explaining it to them now. And then we'll break them into groups and then I'll let you know when you have it.
Okay, perfect. Now, Solomon, there's one thing to add. All right, this is the hint. Students are allowed to rip the paper to help build. If the students feel that they need to start over, if available, you could throw away the ripped paper and replace them with a new sheet of paper so they could have a maximum of two pieces of paper.
Emily, are you working this?
I'm transforming.
Transforming. One of our other former students, William, I asked him to join in. William, how you doing? You know, as they're formulating these towers, I just want to say that you know, this is exciting because when I ask my nieces all the time, how would they like to change the world for themselves and things? You know what? I think the answer is clear by connecting the two continents together, bringing us back, and making sure that we're, you know, have a kind of a good not just a cultural exchange, but a dialogue that will inspire us to, you know, think about, you know, coming back and forth to the continent. And, you know, there's a lot that's at stake here, especially as we think about the future and our generations and thinking about artificial intelligence and thinking about, you know, the technologies. It's amazing how we're in this space right here and various locations in Africa and, of course, in the States. So thank you, Dean. Let's say, Dean, I think he's going to have to go, but thank you, Dean. Appreciate you. And I'll send the recording.
All right, thanks. And thanks, Maury. Just, my sons are 10 and 11, so you just gave me an idea, and maybe I need to send them to your classroom. So this is really good. I'm like, oh, that's great. And then I'm struggling over here with Emily too, brainstorming on how I would actually be able to do it. So you got me challenged. All right, we're gonna be both in the, and I'll be in the classroom too. So, but thanks everybody. This really is beautiful.
Yes, well, I have plenty of ideas and activities. So.
Okay, I'll be looking for you. All right, thanks again, everybody. Thanks, students. Thanks, Dr. Hackett. Thanks, Dr. Hackett.
In the meantime, while they're formulating this, why don't we, introduce, to Princess and Emily, they're the younger students. Why don't you guys introduce yourselves and tell them what you do, what you major in, and what college you guys are from within the university. And anybody can start.
Go ahead, Princess.
Hi, my name is Princess. I'm 15 years old. I'm a current student at Palmdale High School. My first year, I am actually in the medical program as of right now, but I just transferred to the engineering program. High school in the beginning is kind of hard to get through, but once you get the hang of it, it'll kind of become easier. A reason I'm taking engineering is because the medical field for me is just not it. I think I'll do better in engineering. The school that I've been looking at that my teachers have been talking a lot about is actually CSUN, because they want us to get ready to go to college. AVID is a hard process too. All I want to know is just to be more successful for myself and become a better person as growing up in this world.
Amen. Amen. Well, welcome, Princess. Your name is appropriate.
Thank you.
Emily, why don't you tell them who you are, what school you go to, what are your future aspirations?
Hi, I'm Emily. I'm 14. I go to Northridge Middle School. It's my last year. I have no idea what high school I'm going to. And as of now, my future looks pretty open. I'm still unsure about what my future is going to look like.
Talk about how you're a speed reader.
Yes, I speed read. Speed reading is not good. It's more like some people speed read, so you can read every fifth word and they only get a good reader, but I can read faster, probably without reading a lot. I can read 500 page books in my day, so that's really helpful.
All right. And how many languages do you speak?
I speak two languages. I speak English and French, and I am in the process of learning.
All right. All right. Very proud of you, niece. So it's kind of staticky, but I think they heard you, and the good thing is we can read through the live transcript. All right, students of CSUN, why don't you introduce yourselves?
Good morning, everybody. My name is Kamal Pruitt. I'm a fourth year student at Cal State Northridge, majoring in Africana Studies. My future goals after graduation are to attend law school, to advocate for other inner city youth like myself, to give more opportunities to them, as well as embark upon an entrepreneurial journey to hopefully one day write a book like my brother Leo Clifton did here, to be able to teach and inspire the next generation of students.
You're doing it, brother. I'm just honored and humbled to be in this room with you right now.
Likewise, brother. I appreciate everybody for presenting me with the opportunity to be here. It's definitely an honor.
Let's turn it over to Kayla now.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Kayla Sproul. I attend CSUN. I'm majoring in psychology, minoring in sociology. I feel very blessed to have this opportunity provided by Professor Hackett. I'm just really excited. As you guys know, last weekend, the event was very inspirational. So I'm really happy and blessed to be here today. And I'm glad to see some familiar faces, some new faces. And I'm just glad to see the students just looking at them working right now. It's enlightening. So it's just fun to see like an actual illustration of them and seeing how this event can come into fruition and just see them excel. So I'm really excited, and I'm really excited to hear you guys all speak and talk. So I hope you guys have a good event.
All right. What's your future aspiration?
My future aspiration is to have a medical field, medical office, my own medical office within the Black community, and hopes to promote mental health for the Black community. So whichever way I'm able to do that with my psychology degree and as well. So I'm just trying to find ways to implement that and implement this event. So kind of like make them collide and just find a continuum. So that's my future aspiration. So thank you for
perhaps minor. And perhaps minor in Africana studies?
Perhaps minor in Africana studies. This events like these are honestly going to push me further to look into that. So I think I will at the end of my graduation, I think I will.
Oh, yes. Well, thank you, Kayla. I appreciate it. And I'm
thank
glad
you,
to have her as a research assistant in the Du Bois Hamer Institute. We have lots to do, Dr. Gamage. all right, Rashid, take it away.
Hello, everyone. My name is Rashid Gladden. I'm a fourth-year senior here at CSUN, major in Africana Studies. My future aspirations is to empower the youth by creating programs such as Go to AO and write a book such as Leo, and just, you know, make sure that the youth understand their identity and understand that their history is important and rich. So that's pretty much what I plan to have to do in the future, is to empower the youth and continue to teach and, you know, following Dr. Hackett footsteps.
And Dr. Gamage's footsteps. So she has, she has three books.
Dr. Gamage as well. And a round of applause to Dr. Gamage.
You will make
thank
it
you.
Happen.
Thank you, Rashid. And I love that hair, man. It's getting longer. Every time I see you, it's just boom.
Yeah, I'm growing it out. Freedom. It's a sign of freedom.
Yes.
You know, breaking on barriers. Them preconceived modes of who we supposed to be or what we supposed to look like, you know.
Absolutely.
Larry, right now, you're going to be a general soon when you get those dreads, those full dreads.
It's just baby locks.
Sorry about that. Larry, do you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah. Hello, everybody. Good morning and good afternoon to both of y'all. My name is Larry Biakuse, and I'm a third year junior at CSUN. I'm a physical therapy major, and I'm a kinesiology major, and I plan to go into physical therapy in order to promote better health and like health education within communities. And I think that's it, right? Oh, you're muted.
Yeah, pretty much talking about your future aspiration and what you're going to do with physical therapy. You know, it's funny. I was a kinesiology major once. I think I changed my major like 7 times. I wanted to save the world and, you know, kind of landed, and now we're blooming where we're planted. So thank you for that, Mr. Larry. All right. Now, my good friend Leo, please introduce yourself and tell us who you are and what you're doing.
Atlantis World, Leonard Clifton, author of The Last Prince of Atlantis Chronicles. I'm honored to work on this groundbreaking pilot program with Dr. Cedrick Hackett, CSUN, Golden Aya. I'm just honored that you guys are reading this book and you're literally absorbing all the information and you're breaking it down and the themes. It's incredible. So I'm just honored to be in this room with all of you today. Thank you for having me.
And the good thing is that we'll be able to, when we go into the next segment, we'll get a chance to have some of our students in the Real Black Men Read program read, the beginning chapter, and then maybe discuss it with some of the questions that folks in my equity and diversity class have come up with in terms of creating a study guide. This is exciting because I plan on doing this for all three of the books in that class. And it's a great way to center Blackness, as Leo would say, protagonist characters inside fantasy and sci-fi. And it's just beautiful.
Truly honored. Sun Ra. I've never seen the video, the introduction.
Right. Sun Ra in the 70s, he started this whole aspect of Afrofuturism, right? Then we look at Octavia Butler. We look at a host of others who have decided to create futures. And, you know, Leo's calling his the multiverse of it because of the multicultural characters and some of the important themes like foster youth. I know Leo, wants to donate to foster youth once gets this movie out. You know, with what happened over the last week with
Micaiah Bryant, talking, she was in the foster care. A lot of these foster homes are not really fostering kids. They're literally just have bodies for money. And you see that what happened. And it's unfortunate that one of our own double teaming this young lady who just wanted to not be harassed. And unfortunately the cops come. They don't listen, they just react, and now she's gone. So I pray with the universe that this franchise happens so I can save kids like Micaiah in the future.
Thank you, Leo. All right, we'll turn it back over to Amor as we're looking at these wonderful towers that are being built by the students in the Golden Area Corp. And I don't know what Emily's doing. I don't know, Princess, are you making a tower or are you just observing because you're in high school now? You're seasoned.
I'm observing.
Great. I hope we get to have you at CSUN. But you might be looking at a research one to do what you're doing, right?
No, I'm trying to push you to go to CSUN. Princess, no. Gotta keep the alumni strong.
Right. Kamau, I think it's important. I'm glad that you typed in Micaiah's name. Why don't we all say Micaiah's name and just bring her spirit into this space? Because now she's an ancestor, unfortunately. But let's bring her into this space in terms of what we're doing. Because, you know, we are on the shoulders of folks who passed so young and those that we gain wisdom from. So let's say her name, Micaiah Bryant.
Micaiah Bryant.
Micaiah Bryant.
Micaiah Bryant.
Micaiah Bryant.
And so, Solomon, since you're on, and while your students are still building this tower, just tell tell us a little bit about why you created the Golden Aya.
Okay, yeah, sure. Hello, everyone. My name is Solomon. Nice to meet you all. Thank you all for being a part of this. Thank you all for joining. The reason why we created Golden Ada is because we wanted to make a change in the world. And one way that we decided to do that was starting with our own people on the continent. So we really wanted to have an impact that would actually make a difference. So our organization is Golden Ada Corp. We are a pan-African nonprofit organization based out of Miami, Florida, with one branch here in Arusha, Tanzania. We focus on education, health, and development. So right now you all are participating in our education portion of what we do, which is an E plus STEAM after school program, which is English, science, technology, engineering, art, and mathematics. And in our mathematics part, we also include financial literacy. So the students are learning things about ownership, equity, stocks, savings, and the whole nine when it comes to financial literacy. And that's pretty much it in a nutshell. Right now, we're actually currently working to raise funds so we can build a school. Yesterday, we met our goal of raising $6,000 for the month of April. We ended with $6,500 or around that. So we're very thankful for all of our supporters, everyone that helped this campaign, Dr. Hackett, Leo, and everyone that was involved. We appreciate that for sure.
Congratulations, man. This is great news to hear.
Yes, congrats. Congrats, Solomon. Well deserved.
And we'll continue to help fundraise and bring the resources, whether it's fiscal or in kind, back to the continent. And I can't wait till they open up the borders again for travel. I got to renew my passport so we can get out there. I know Dr. Gamage was about to bring students out to Africa. Dr. Gamage, did you want to talk a little bit about what your endeavor was and what you plan on doing once the borders open up?
Sure. We partnered with San Diego State University with their Alternative Spring Break and Study Abroad programs, where we were inviting students to join us on this alternative or spring break away program in Ethiopia. And we were actually scheduled to depart the week in which the U.S. enforced its regulations around COVID, and CSUN moved us to the away model, right, the virtual model, and banned all travel. So unfortunately, we didn't get to board our plane and go. However, we hope to return that program, in which the program has partnered in Ghana, in South Africa, in Brazil as well. And hopefully we can then partner in the future in Tanzania. It's a learning experience where the students get to engage in a virtual and sometimes in-person learning environment, as well as we get to do service work where we partner with local organizations to provide services. We also do a lot of fundraising around school supplies, personal supplies and things like that. And so we take extra luggage with us on those trips, and we are able to gift those things to the local community. We partner with different women's organization, family-based organizations as well, a lot of schools. And so it would be great to return that program and invite our students out once again to be able to take their spring breaks or their summer breaks and study and learn abroad.
Oh yeah. I think that I'll be looking forward to taking advantage of it. And if I don't get funding from CSUN, I'll pay it out of my own pocket to get there. I'm so inspired by my colleague, Dr. Gamage, who will eventually be the chair of our department. So you're looking at the future chair there, okay?
Congratulations, Dr. Gamage.
Yes. Dr. Hackett is prophesizing.
Congratulations.
Yes, so we need her sooner than later, but we'll keep moving.
It's always been about, and Amori knows this, knows that it's always been about my service to students and creating exceptional educational opportunities for our students. We do that with our conferences, our journals, to give them opportunity to publish their work, study abroad opportunities, internships, And so, and that's what makes our jobs fulfilling, right? And worthwhile is the opportunity to serve and work with our students, because we get to see the brilliant, bright stars that they become, right? In their professional and personal lives. And so thank you for this opportunity to join you all today and see some of our great alumni as well. So good to see you all.
I like to add Dr. Gammon, she's an amazing professor. I'm currently in grad school working on my master's, and all the tools that you taught me when it comes to publication, I'm using that now. And I'm even referring back to my old stuff. And I'm like, where is that assignment I did in Dr. Gammage class? So that definitely helped me build the foundation, especially being the only Black student in the master's program. So competing with my colleagues, the tools that you gave me is helping me along the way.
Thank you. That is awesome. Awesome testimony. The testimony is just great. And it just gets better and better. And I can say that with regards to the publication, I'm encouraging Kayla to submit her work into the publication this year. And so I'm hoping that we can look at that. And Larry, your group, they need the public to submit as well. Go ahead.
Yeah, this was the journal from last year that the students got to. We actually spotlight the students' artwork. And so there's a student review committee. So the students get to select the artwork, select the theme for the journal. And they also are the review committee for all the submissions as well. And we do that in our pro seminar, senior seminar class. That's our capstone course, their final course that they take as they complete the degree program. And I was so fortunate they have the opportunity to now take over that course. And so we created the conference and the journal out of that course, which is funded by our grant. And so this year's theme is Black Lives Matter, Addressing It All, selected by the students. And we're welcoming submissions for research articles, as well as art for the cover. Students are paid for their artwork. and so if you have any artist friends that you think might benefit, we pay around $500. And so let them know that we are commissioning some artwork for the cover. We also are accepting abstracts for the upcoming conference on May 6th. And so if anyone's interested in presenting their research on May 6th, we'll be having a virtual conference as well. So I hope to see some of you all there.
Oh, I will definitely be giving incentives to join that. And it's on my birthday too. So that's a awesome. Good thing.
I just want to ask one question to Dr. Gammage. So Brazil, that's beautiful because, you know, Brazil has the second largest population of Africans outside of Africa is in Brazil. So are you going to be in Bahia? Which part of Brazil?
We actually tend to tour multiple different places. And so, yes, that's one of them. Yes. And we tend to do that one over the summer. It gives us a little longer because, you know, the spring break is a week. So we tend to go for around 10 days. We extend it a little longer than a week. So we go around 10 days when we take those alternative spring break trips. But for the summer, we get to go a little longer, sometimes up to 3 weeks. And so we get to tour multiple places in the country. So even when we were planning to go to Ethiopia this last March, we were actually planning on visiting 5 different cities. And so in that time frame, we do a lot of traveling as well. So a lot of stamps on the passport.
That's beautiful. I love Brazil.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. All right. So I'm going to turn it back over to Amor. It looks like they're finishing up their other pieces. And so thank you for that, knowledge nugget, I guess I would say. And Amor, take it away.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Hackett. And thank you, Dr. Gammage, for sharing all of the great news to come. I'm truly excited. All right. So student Solomon, are you ready to go? Okay. All right, students, you did it. I see amazing towers. They're standing. All right. I've been looking and they have been standing longer than 30 seconds. All right, and from my view, it looks like they're taller than a meter stick.
Wow.
All right, so I am sharing my screen again. All right, so you all completed the paper tower assignment. Here are some photos from my class. You can see there's a meter stick, and the student, he was short, and he just put a paper clip at the top, all right, to kind of make it as tall as a meter stick. So
innovative.
Yes. You took the exact word that I was going to say. So being innovative, you know, brainstorming in order to solve the problem, working with what you have. In the picture on the right, this student had a different unique design where they used their own formula to fold the paper in order to stack up the tower. So there's different ways that you all can complete this. Students, I see you all with the tower, more with the cylinder model, and it looks great. So good job, clap it up. Excellent job, students. All right, I see some smiles there. Students are happy to have completed the challenge. And you can apply this through anything that you go through. So sometimes you have to work with what you have in order to build, all right? In order to become successful. In the beginning, when I told you two pieces of paper and 10 paper clips, you may have said, how are we going to do this? This sounds impossible. But you did it. You were able to build the tower. All right. So apply that through anything that you go through in life. Okay. So good job, students, once again. Awesome.
I'd like to ask the students, Solomon, how did they feel making the towers? All right. I didn't quite catch that, but. All right, look at that king over there. Look at that young king over there. Standing to attention. Gotta love it. This is like a movie, Leonard. You know, I think we may have to add this to the movie.
You can see them admiring their towers there.
In the documentary.
Right. Kamal, he made a comment in the chat. Kamal, why don't you take it away and give us a positive affirmation?
Yeah, I really think this is a great activity you did here, Amor. I think that for me, growing up, it was very hard for me to kind of just have the things that everybody else has and is given to them. So this whole working with what you got idea is so key and is an essential lifelong lesson here, because all my life I had to work with what I had. And just for the next generation of students coming up after me, I want to say that it always does get better, and your circumstances do not define you, you define them. And it's key and it's imperative that we constantly remind ourselves of that, because we didn't ask to inherit the things that we got. But we can definitely control, and we have the power to determine what that looks like in our lifetime. So I honestly think that's a great activity, Amora. This was great.
Oh, thank you for that. Yes, we are definitely true engineers at heart. You know,
absolutely,
what you got at the end of the day. So yes, we could all relate to that. So, but thank you for sharing. Yeah.
Princess, what did you think about their building of the towers? As you are reminded of what you did in Amor's class.
It brought back a lot of memories, because this project was really fun. It brought back a lot of memories. Just seeing them build that made me smile.
Oh, that's good. Thank you. Thank you for that. Emily, did you build your tower? Are you taking this all in?
I tried. I'm not very creative these days, and it doesn't even stand.
It's coming, but you know, you didn't have any help. But the good thing is that you're looking at it. It's almost like a parallel play when we look at this. All right, let's give a round of applause. This has been a great activity. I am so inspired by what these kids have been able to do. And what we're going to do is, do you want to, any lasting words, Amor?
Thank you all for this opportunity, Solomon. Thank you for inviting me into your virtual space in order to facilitate this activity. This is amazing. I even have my husband on the side. He's kind of watching from a distance and he's like, this is awesome. So thank you all.
Amori, I just want to say watching this and watching you is so inspiring. I forgot about, I read this book, The Boy Who Harnessed the Wind. True story about this kid who created this tower because they didn't have any water. And I forgot which country he was in. I think it's Kenya. It was such an inspiring book. By doing what you're doing, this demonstration reminded me of this book. So I just wanted to share.
Oh, wow, thank you. Yeah, I'm definitely going to check that one out.
Wow. Look at all this Black excellence, this Black Odyssey-driven excellence. We bowed, right, Amor? All right, so now we're going to shift. Solomon, do you have any lasting words that you want to say to your students and what wonderful job that they did in this activity?
First, Amor, thank you so much for leading us in this exercise. We really do appreciate it. And your students, great job. Keep up the good work. And you know how we do. We always push forward.
Remember that Ubuntu, I am because we are, and this is what we're doing. It's really about creating and exploring our minds and thinking about how we can continue to make a difference and build bridges, right? Build bridges and not creeks. So we're gonna switch gears a little bit. Thank you, Amor, you are awesome. You are the future, you know, to teach this Generation Z and Generation Alpha generation. And also to try to get them thinking about jobs that don't even exist yet, because it'll be in their minds, right, in terms of what they can do in the future. So I'm going to shift over to play this video as we look at the Real Black Men Read program. I thought it's a great video. And hang on. Let me make sure that I share the sound. Okay.
I just want to say shout out to this book, The Last Prince of Atlantis, Chronicles. And this is the first book, and I've been reading this, and it's actually a really, really, really good book. I love it. So we're going to tell you our favorite parts about it and why you should get this book. It's a really good book. Why you guys should get this book. And, it's a really good book. So Caleb's going to tell you his favorite part.
My favorite part is when Alan meets Athena, and they go back to her house because of the diamond and stuff.
Yeah, when it's really cool. You got to, like, read it. You got to read it. You have no clue what he's talking about. But if you read this, you'll know what he's talking about, and that part's pretty dope. My favorite part is when, like, he figures everything out and stuff, and they swim down to the underwater tree of life. You know, that part was pretty dope. When they're down there, he rode the dolphin down there. That part was pretty dope. But, yeah, so all in all, this is just a really good book. And you guys should just go check it out. Especially because the school year is about to start. And I know y'all don't want to admit it, but y'all are going to have to read. And, I mean, y'all want some crappy books? Like, that have no meaning, you know? You want some crappy books? Or y'all want to get some good books, okay? This book, amazing. I just want to say, it's amazing. it's real, like, if y'all know me, I hate reading. I hate reading. But I actually read this book.
What's this? The Prince of Atlantis Chronicles. Alan King is an unassuming black teenager living in a blue-collar family in Miami, Florida. After finding a magical crystal necklace, he discovers that he's actually an Atlantean prince. Suddenly, things change for the gawky teenager. He gains the power of telepathy and teleportation and finds that he's able to communicate with sea animals. Along with a beautiful Greek goddess, his orphan best friends, and a zany uncle, Alan keeps the Earth safe as they fight against his mortal enemies in an attempt to restore his kingdom, the lost city of Atlantis. Whoa. So, like, Aquaman, but like, black Aquaman. Okay, I'm gonna read this now.
So hopefully that kind of jazzes us up a little bit. This is the hour where we're going to have our students actually read the first chapter. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the spotlight on a few of our students who will be. And 1 second here. I set this up. All right, so all right, so we're going to start reading the first chapter and then have the students discuss with a few discussion prompts. And obviously we have to read slowly so that they can translate. But I think this is good that we have the live audio so that, you know, serves two purposes. It's kind of a win-win, you know, to where we're thinking about literacy. As I was told, the main language is Swahili. But they are learning English, and this is good. So let me do this and start over. Remove all spotlights and then add the spotlights. Okay, so we got, boom. We have, boom. And Larry, are you going to put your video on? Are you able to put your video on?
My video's not on?
No, I can only see your picture.
Wait a minute. Wait, I can see you perfectly.
No, not you. I'm saying Larry. Oh. There you are, Larry. Yeah, so I can put the spotlight. There you are, Larry. How you doing, brother? It's growing his dreads too. Looking good.
Yeah.
And Kayla,
yeah, we're doing good. You.
Put your spotlight on, so our camera, so we can spotlight you.
I'm only able to pull up the story on my phone, so it's gonna have me on pause on the video. So if that's fine.
Oh, I was going to share my screen and show the chapter so we can read along
okay.
That way.
Yeah. Okay.
There you are. Okay. So you guys are going to be the Fantastic Four. We have about, the first chapter is about six pages. And I will go ahead and share. Could you guys all see that?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what we will do, what we'll do is we'll go ahead and start reading. All right, who would like to start reading the first page?
I'll start us off.
Okay. Oh, wait, who just said that I'll start us off?
Cam.
Okay, Cam, go for it. Take it away.
All right. Alan's eerie dreams keep him safe from his bully. Chapter one.
Hang on, sorry.
It's okay.
Okay.
All right. On Mount Olympus, my eyes are focused on Earth. I see the teenager I have been watching. He runs away from the guy bullying him. Josh Stone chases Alan King off the boardwalk in his car in Miami, Florida. Alan feels like his heart is about to pound out of his chest as he runs through a park, losing Josh. I want none of my fellow Greek gods to know what I'm doing at the moment. I grab my lightning bolt and speedily leave Mount Olympus to Acropolis in Athens. I look like a mortal wearing dress pants, casual shoes, and a short sleeve shirt walking on Athanasiou Daiku Street, approaching a doorman. The doorman stands in front of the hotel next to my apartment building. He smiles at me. I say, hello, as I walk into my building and take the elevator up to the fifth floor. I open the door to my new apartment with earth-toned walls, a white reclining sofa, and a glass coffee table facing the HD TV mounted on the wall in the living room. I go outside and sit in a chair on the balcony across from my Zeus temple, the mortals worship. My feelings have been stirring towards Alan King. He could change the course of history to my world and his. I have been watching Alan for some time and everyone close to him. I can sense I will unexpectedly meet him as I observe with my mind's eye and talk quietly to myself. On Mount Olympus, I talk a little too much as I contemplate.
All right, stop there. Pass it to one of your colleagues.
I'll throw this one over. Pete.
All right. I watch Alan rushing through the front door of his home. He hears his mother say, Alan, you're late for dinner. Alan passes his family and say, I'm sorry, not feeling so well. I'm going to bed. He goes up the stairs to his bedroom, takes off his shoes, and falls onto his bed on a hot and humid Friday evening. Alan soon falls into a deep sleep, tossing to and fro. His 6'1" mocha skin body is draped across the two small twin-sized bed. He sleeps in the hottest room in the Modis two-story house. He is saturated in sweat from the top of his short black dreads to the bottom of his dangling feet. Alan has eerie dreams as he burrows his face into his pillow. He hears a slow, rhythmic African tribal drum beat with a creepy growling noise, which mimics the tribal sound. Suddenly, large oval shape fury red eye appear out of the darkness. Their weird glare illuminates the king and queen lying in an extravagant gold bed embedded with pearls and crimson velvet curtains draped around the foundation of which royal crowns were embroidered. The creature's growl overtakes the sound of the tribal drums as it displays a long white dragon fangs. Without warning, the queen screams instantly, goes chaotic. The king has been killed. Alan grabs his sweat-saturated bed sheets as he capulated from one wild dream to another. He stands unsteadily, trying to keep his balance while the room rocks as if it was an earthquake had just ejected him out of his bed. He scans the room and spies the king and queen. Who are surrounded by the red-hot light? It glows brighter and hotter until an atomic explosion joists Alan awake. He sits up, throws the wet sheets off his skinny body, and whispers to himself, "What a strange dream. A king and queen? A dragon? I think I've listened to too many of my Uncle Zadok's weird stories."
Stop there. And who will take
I'll go it over? There.
Okay.
Summer school classes are done for the day, and Alan grabs a few things from his dented, army green, metal locker before going to play basketball with his two best friends. He rushes around the corner and slams into the 17-year-old jock, Josh Stone, South Beach, Miami high star basketball player, a star wrestler, and varsity quarterback. He's tall, muscular, broad-shouldered, half Indian, half Black, and good-looking. To keep from failing, Josh grabs onto his gorgeous girlfriend, Mercedes, causing her to drop her books on the shiny concrete. Alan's face heats up, and he wheezes as he rushes to scoop up Mercedes' books. Alan wheezes, "Hey, Mercedes, sorry." Dusting himself off, Josh snarls and says, "You skinny idiot. Watch where you're going with those big webbed feet." Reaching into his jacket pocket for his inhaler, Alan stammers, I'm sorry, Josh. I caught you eyeing my Black queen. I bet you fantasize about Mercedes wearing her cheerleader outfit, don't you?" Josh snatches Alan's inhaler, springs it in the air, and alley-oops into a nearby trash can where he touches the ground. Josh Stone does an alley-oop and scores. Mercedes glares at Josh. "Josh, don't do that to Alan." She looks at Alan and smiles. "He's a nice guy, and we're neighbors." Josh pouts at Mercedes, watches Alan reach into the trash can and retrieve his inhaler. Alan puts it under from a rotten banana peel and wipes it off on his t-shirt. He avoids Josh's demeaning stare and Mercedes' "I'm so sorry" expression. He sticks the inhaler in his mouth and huffs once, twice, three times. His breathing returns to normal, and he relaxes a little until he catches Josh's eye.
All right, stop there. Pass it to the next person.
Josh Mouth, watch out. Josh Mouth, watch out. And shrinks nastily. He grabs Mercedes' arm and pulls her away. Feeling a shrug of anxiety, Alan runs as fast as he can to the basketball hoop. I lost my place. Hold on. Okay. Wait. Alan runs as fast as he can to the basketball court on the park near his house to meet his best friends, Francisco Gomez and Jake O'Connor, who are also 15. Francisco is shorter and stocky, a Cuban American with dark, short, chopped hair. Brown eyes and a scar that cut through the end of his right brow. He likes to brag he got it when he was only 10 while fighting with a 17-year-old boy in the orphanage bathroom. He prides himself on his swagger and goes and does the means of impersonation of Tony Montana from Scarface. His favorite movie of all time. Jake is a scrawny with shaggy blonde with shaggy brown hair and wide pale blue. His favorite outfit is a murky Miami versus t-shirt, ripped blue jeans, and a dirty skateboard sneakers with a gaping hole in the right toe. Jake can be shy and is often understanding, but But when pushed, he rarely backs down from a fight. Francisco and Jay constantly consider each other brothers, having grown up together in an orphanage. They now live together in a group home and have been best friends with Alan since they were in the first grade. Francisco notices Alan racing towards the court. "What's up, Alan? Why are you running like you're scared?" Alan skids to stop in front of Francisco and takes another hit from his inhaler. "It's nothing, guys. I'm good. The heat is getting to me, that's all." Jake nods. "Okay, dude. You ready to ball with the other three guys from school?" Alan smiles and nods. "Yes, let's do it." He goes up for a ball, instantly palming it and dribbling it between his legs like he's playing in the NBA. He does a behind the back no look pass to Jake, who does a bank shot and scores.
Okay, stop there. And we'll go to the next person who would like to take it away.
I could pick back up.
Perfect. Go ahead.
I'm sorry, Hack. We were on the part that says playing in the NBA, correct?
Yes. Right here from bank shot and scores.
Okay. He does a behind the back no look pass to Jake, who does a bank shot and scores. Jake yells, "That's how to pass, dude." Alan gets the ball and shoots a three-pointer, hitting the net flawlessly and making a swish sound. Francisco screams excitedly, "Yeah, bro, we're about to win this game." Josh saunters up to the court with a few of his football pals. He watches the game for a moment, then says snidely, well, if it isn't the bumbling beanpole who ran into me. I should take those Jordans off your feet and throw them in the trash along with your pacifier. Oh, and look, he's with his friends, the teen orphs. Francisco looks at Josh, laughs mockingly, and says, well, if it isn't the jerk with his douchebag friends. You're just jealous Alan lives in Bayshore across the street from your girlfriend. Sneering, Josh retorts, I know one of you assholes keyed the side of my vintage black Mustang. You have no way of proving that. You're lucky whoever did it didn't jack you for your rims, says Jake. One of Josh's linebacker friends intervenes. Let it go, Josh. You know how crazy the teen orphs can be. They never back down from a fight. Francisco laughs like a maniac. Yeah, let it go, Joshy boy. You want a piece of me? He throws a few air punches and shouts. Okay, let's do it, punk. I'll bite your ear off. Jake eggs Francisco on. Do it, friend. I want to wear his ear as a necklace. Alan steps in. Come on, Francisco. Let it go, bro.
All right, just stop there. And go ahead and take it home, Rasheed.
Josh pushes Alan down hard. You stay out this, you lanky-ass nerd. Francisco and Jake flank Alan, ready for a fight. While Alan slowly gets up, with Josh hovering mechanically over him and other guys playing with them walked in the middle, breaking it up before Francisco or Jake do anything serious. Jake shots out Josh as they walk off the basketball court. Screw yourself in your football jerk offs. You mess with one of us, and you mess with the other. You mess with the three musketeers.
Let's stop there for a minute. Thank you. Great job for the reading. It's always excruciating reading aloud. We're so used to reading in our heads. And so this is always good. And you're getting a round of applause from the Golden AS students. And again, you know, some of us, English is not our first language. So, this is all, what I'm going to do is ask a question and have you guys just kind of dialogue on naming characters in the story and who's the main character. Yeah. and anybody but can
I was Alan is the main character in the story.
And who are some of the other characters in the story so far?
We have Josh. Jake.
You have Josh. Who's Josh? Who's Josh, Caleb?
I believe he's the bully.
He is the bully. He is the bully, yes. And then we have Jake. And you have Jake. And who's Jake?
One of his best friends.
One of his best friends. And they mentioned any other characters?
Mercedes.
Who is Mercedes?
Josh's gorgeous girlfriend.
His gorgeous girlfriend, right? You guys don't know about that yet. You guys are young kids right now, but eventually you'll have a mate that you can have fun, talk to and study with and all those other good things. Who's your favorite character and why so far?
I would say Jake and Francisco. It's because how they're standing up for their friend, you know. It's obvious that their friend is intimidated by the bully, and they're standing up for him because they understand that that's their friend, and that's how it should be. And so I respect.
Go ahead. Sorry, go ahead.
That's it. I just wanted to say that.
Have you ever had a friend stand up for you from a bully, you know, in your formative years growing up before you guys got into college? Like, just say the ages of the students that we see at the Golden Air between ages 7 and 12, I believe. During that time, have you ever had a bully and somebody stick up for you that you called a friend? And anybody can answer that.
Absolutely. Growing up, I was always shorter than a lot of my classmates. So many people would always try to pick on me for my height. And I just remember having this one friend who was a little bit taller than me. So he was at the level to where I guess you weren't able to basically get made fun of because you reached that height limit. And I just remember one day he came and he stuck up for me, and he basically just explained how instead of me having height, he kind of just emphasized my other strengths, which was my intelligence, which was my ability to run fast. And he kind of just made me feel good about myself in ways that I didn't necessarily realize, because I honestly just was so subconscious about being shorter than all my classmates. So just understanding the fact that my friend just really, he emphasized my intelligence and my strength, my ability to run fast. And other kids started to appreciate my strengths versus kind of just downing me for my weaknesses. And that same guy is actually one of my closest friends to this day. So honestly, that one moment when he stuck up for me as kids, it created a brotherhood that I really see inherent in this story between Francisco and I believe it was Jake, who considered themselves brothers. And they stuck together to fight against the bully in this story, which I honestly saw myself in as that young boy when my friend did that for me.
Wow, thank you for that. You know, I have a funny story to share too, but I'll wait and defer to Larry or Rashid or Kayla. Do you guys have a story similar to Kamau's? Or from your own observation, or it happening to you personally?
In my experience, I would say people did stand up for me. Like when I first came, I would transfer schools a bit. And when I arrived at my Granite Point Elementary School, I had people stand up. At first I tried to play soccer with a few kids, but they didn't really let me play, mainly because I was different, and one person stood up for me. And because of that, I grew more friendships just by him letting me be on his team for the day.
Oh man, great story. Great story. Thank you for sharing that, Larry. Anybody else?
I would say also... I was more like Jake. In Francisco, as far as stand up for people. I remember I used to stand up for my older brother when I was, because I understand, like, you know, in middle school, how the guys, you know, how they play. So I thought people was bullying my older brother. So I go over there and make a whole scene, but it was just playing. But I didn't know. I'm thinking they bullying my brother. And that was a funny incident. But I always was the guy trying to alleviate problems, trying to help people. So I was always like the nurturer in the situations.
Oh, you're the voice of reason, huh? Good, good. Thank you for that, Rasheed. I did bring Princess and Emily back in as well. Kayla, did you have a similar story? Because I'm going to ask them if they observed something similar to that in their personally, or whether or not you observe something or you see yourself in some of these characters, whether or not you're sticking up for somebody who's being bullied. Or those kind of things. Kayla, did you have anything?
Fortunately, I haven't. I've never had I've never been bullied, but I have seen people get bullied before. So like my colleague said, like, I've always been like the more nurturing one, the one that's trying to alleviate their problems. So I'm more that person. So nobody, like in middle school, like nobody really seen me as a type to like pick on, but I would see people get picked on. So that's when I knew I kind of had like a voice for other people, is just by me being in elementary school and middle school, just being able to be that person that people can come to and then kind of like not really like scare the other kids, but they know I'm not like the one to mess with. So I was just that person for people. So if they felt weak, then I was able to be their anchor pretty much. So I've just observed that.
So they would come to you if they were getting bullied and you stick up for them. That's perfect.
I mean, just like my friends, not like the whole school, not like, oh, she's the one. No, not like that or nothing. But yeah, just like my friends. So they know, like, I'm kind of like the stronger one within the group. They can come to me. They know me.
Nice.
Get it then.
This is good. Leo, I know you're being inspired by this in terms of thinking about how these stories, there's a frame of reference in terms of, you know, how we've grown up in our different spaces.
Yeah, I was shedding a little bit of tears, like just hearing you read from chapter one and share your experiences, real life experiences, like the characters in the book. It's so parallel. It's amazing. I'm just like you guys. Like Alan, every time I remember growing up, even in kindergarten, somewhere fight, I just run in the middle, break it up. Why y'all fight? Break it up. You know, stop it. And then in high school, bigger guys, like high school, like football players fighting, I'm like, same thing. Break it up. My friends like, man, you always in the middle, try to break it up. Break it up. Try to dodge their punches, just trying to stop them fighting. You know, friends don't fight.
Now, Princess, do you have a similar story in terms of anybody you observed? Did you stick up for somebody? Have you ever gotten picked on? Did you guys have a school bully?
I've been picked on a few times just out of random, but usually it was this one time at track I was picked on. Supposed to be, I was a slower runner and I didn't think anything of it. I just didn't really mind. I'm like, okay, they're just saying words. And they ended up losing. So after that, I'm like, see, it's whatever. It's really whatever at this point. And that's basically what happened. I've been picked on a few times, though.
And then with Princess, I could say, I could vouch for, she always had a home base. So that helped. Being a part of the Black Student Union on campus, she was always able to run to my classroom to tell me what's going on in order to kind of alleviate and fix situations. So yeah, that creating that community on campus definitely helped with the fights and the bullying that was going on campus.
Oh, thank you for sharing. Emily, do you have a similar story in terms of a school bully, or I know you're the person probably stuck up for people.
Yeah, everyone else is all, and
And I'm always on my own, but she would always come to me and ask me for advice. So whenever they pick on her, I would be like, you know what? If you're alone and you're going to have to deal with me, no one wants to deal with me because I'm genuine and very.
Thank you for sharing that. This has been great. I do have one other question, and that is, what kind of dreams did Alan have, bad or good? And have you had a bad dream like that before? And this is for everybody.
I would say, I wouldn't say it was a bad or good dream. I would say it was a sign for what's to come. And I would say I have had dreams like that, that has given me signs to prepare me or to wake me up or to alert me. Because sometimes the universe, that's how the universe talks to us, through dreams, through our thoughts. So I would say, yes, I have had similar dreams such as that. Not to the degree of, me being the king of Atlantis, but, you know, spiritual.
But you are a king.
I am a king in my own way.
Yes, definitely, sir.
Might be Atlantis. I might have Atlantean blood. I might have some Atlantean blood. You never know.
So, you like the water? Yeah.
You're almost a king.
Yeah, I'm a cancer, so we water signs. So I might be a little, you know, a little Aquaman.
Black Aquaman, as Emily put it.
Afro Man. I'm gonna call it Afro.
Afro Man. Okay. That might be a new superhero, kids, in Golden Era. Superhero. Speaking of, does anybody else have any other comments with regards to the dreams? Because I do want to ask a question of the kids in Golden Era.
I just want to add a quick, just add my two cents real quick. Honestly, I really did connect with that part of the story because, like my brother Rashid said, dreams are very spiritual. I think that the things that the ancestors and spiritual forces and spiritual guides necessarily can't physically say to us as in a conscious state, they can definitely reach out to us and talk to us in an unconscious state through our dreams and things like that. So, I definitely have had dreams that have like given me certain wake up calls and certain feelings. And my stepfather recently passed away in 2019, and I've been seeing him so much in my dreams. And I just know it's all symbolic, and it's all something that transcends the physical world that we can't necessarily interact with in terms of like that part of our brain. It only works when we're asleep. So I honestly felt like that part of the story everyone can relate to, because we've all had those dreams that we woke up and we were like, what just happened? You know, what does that mean? And it just kind of makes you just start to think larger, think higher, and just look for more answers out of life. Because if you've had them certain dreams, you know that this can't just be a coincidence. You know, somebody gave you this vision and they let you see this and experience this in a dream for a reason.
Thank you, Kamal. Thank you, Kamal, for that statement. That was very, very, very Kama-ish, you know, because you're higher order thinker. All my students are higher order thinker.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you.
You're welcome. All right, so I wanted to ask a question with the Golden Era kids. With regards to what do you want to do when you grow up? What do you want to be when you grow up? What do you want to be when you grow up? That's the question. Okay, I didn't quite make that out. Make sure you help us translate, because it's hard to Sullivan, you're going to have to help us out because it's hard to hear what they said. So if you can invent anything in the world, if you can invent anything in the world, what would you invent and why?
Dr. Hackett, if you can hear me.
I can hear you now.
Oh, yeah, Dr. Hackett, they said they wanted to be a astronaut,
a soldier, another soldier, and what was the other one?
Engineer.
And a doctor.
A doctor and an engineer.
Oh, okay, so a soldier, doctor, engineer, that's interesting. Ask them why they want to be those things.
Why?
Okay. What do you?
So that you know the situation.
Okay, so in my class, we have two classes. So in my class, the students said they want to be a doctor to help sick people. And then Izan is actually getting the answers from the other class for us. Our audio is a little bit off.
Okay, that's perfect. I'm glad you're translating because this is inspiring for us to hear.
Okay.
I see the hands go raising up. You know, they're eager to tell us what they want to do. Yes, and why. Yes.
Okay, she said she wanted to be an astronaut because we learned about Mae Jemison, the first African American woman in space.
So it was hard to make out. She said she wanted to be an astronaut because I heard Azana Maya a little bit, but I couldn't make out the why. Of being an astronaut.
We learned about Mae Jemison, and she was the first African American woman in space, so she was inspired to be an astronaut.
Oh, I love it. So you already have a role model and somebody you can look up to, somebody who looked like you and shares our skin tone. And someone said scientist, right? Why do you want to be a scientist? I don't know about y'all, but I am inspired.
I want to be an engineer so I can create new things.
Yes. What is the first thing you want to create?
What's the first thing you want to create? What is the first
thing? And we can't see her face.
Like us.
Did you hear it?
No, what'd she say?
She said flying cars.
Flying cars. Oh, wow. Okay.
Yes.
Fly over. Hold on. Fly over. Hi.
So you're going to create a hovercraft?
Say that again?
Is she going to, well, the question is twofold. Are you going to create a hovercraft? And when you do, what are you going to call the car?
What are you going to call it?
Gabby Gina. Yeah. What would you call it?
And again, if you have questions, let's ask some questions of the kids too, because I think it's
important. Who else wants to tell them about what they want to do?
I want to be a doctor because I want to help sick people.
Yes, that's good. And so, do you want to do operations or do you want to create medicine?
Yes.
All right, that's great.
What is her name?
What is your name?
My name is Niza.
Niza.
Okay.
Let's say hi to Niza. Hi, Niza.
Hi, Niza.
Hey.
Hi, Niza.
Hi, Niza.
Hi, Niza. It's nice to meet you.
We're about to get into the cultural exchange portion of it, but I do want to ask a question. And this is what I ask a question of my students is, what is your superpower?
What's your superpower? Hmm? What's your superpower? What power do you want? To fly?
To dance.
Oh, your superpower is dancing. This is good, and health and wellness is important. So let's see us shake our shoulders. let's ask the group here. What is your superpower? Rashid, Amar, Kamal, Emily, Kayla, Princess. What is your superpower, Larry?
I got a couple superpowers, I'm gonna be honest. But I think the one that honestly fulfills me the most is my ability to impact others through my ability to take my thoughts and articulate it into words, to be able to feed someone's soul through my voice.
And I feel that. I received that too, Kamal. I think everybody receives that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
My superpower is to teach hard subjects, such as physics, chemistry, all of the above, and make it simple. I had a situation where Princess, she's currently in higher division math in high school. And she called me and she said, "Miss Jackson, can you help me with this?" And I told her how to do it over the phone in like 5 minutes. And she was like, "How come my teacher just didn't say that?" She's like, "I get it now." So, being able to teach.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome, Amar. And I received that. That's why you were a part and participate in the Black Youth Guidance Forum. And there's a lot of great feedback that I'll share with you later. Emily Rose, what's your superpower? It's kind of static. It's hard to hear.
A real superpower, the one I wish I had.
Both, you can share both.
Well, the one I wish I had is to stop time. And I think my superpower is, well, I'm really good at giving people advice when they need it in times of need. Kind of like a therapist. I'm a therapist.
Oh, okay. All right. Now, why'd you say stop time? Why would you want to stop time?
For sleeping. Duh.
That's right. Okay. Good, good. Princess, what about you?
I would never have to be late.
You never have to be late. That's a good one. You know, that's it runs in the family, niece. Princess, what's your superpower? The one that you wish, you know, and I like what Emily said, the one you wish you had and the one that you possess.
The superpower that I wish I had, it was invisibility, and then the superpower that I have now is communication. I'm good with communication and talking to others.
Wow. Well, share with me why invisibility is a superpower that you wish you had.
It would just be pretty cool to go places without being unnoticed half the time.
Oh, that's real deep right there as we think about being targeted, you know, and oftentimes, I mean, you know, we watch a lot of things on television. It's the sad reality TV that we see ourselves in sometimes. And so I definitely received that, Princess. Thank you for that. All right, let's go into the exchange. Well, actually, wait. Larry, you look like you wanted to express what your superpower is. Because you're looking at me like, hey, you gonna call on me? Larry, I'm calling on you. What's your superpower that you wish you had and the superpower that you think you possess?
A power I wish I had would be the power to control electricity, mainly because Static Shock is my favorite superhero. The power I believe I have now would be my creativity and my patience.
Yes, yes, I definitely agree with that, especially in some of the discussions we've had in our class. You and Kayla both had a profound commentary in our last, chat or our last talk on, you know, the criminal justice system and all these things. And Kayla, so I'll pass it to you now. What superpower do you think you possess and the superpower that you wish you had?
So I believe if I were to have a superpower, I would want the ability to teleport to any time period and then to any destination as well. And I think the power I have is confidence and resilience, like confidence within myself, confidence within my people, my relationships, my academic, like my lifestyle, who I am as a person. And just when I was younger, I was just pretty like insecure. So I would just want to teleport just to see my mom again because she recently passed. And then my confidence just to show her how confident I am and like how different I have grown and just who I've become pretty much. So yeah, those will be my powers for sure. Thank you for asking.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I guess I'll pass it to Leo. Leo, I'll ask you the same question. What is your superpower and what superpower do you wish you also would be possessing?
Well, Brother Cedrick, Dr. Cedrick Hackett, I have to say, I believe now this manifests my superpowers to inspire people to dream bigger. And just, I'm still blown away from, thank you, everyone reading chapter one. Just inspire people. But if I had my superpowers, it would be the same, teleport. I could teleport anywhere. I get bored. I want to go to Greece. Just teleport. Oh, I want to go to Africa. I want some barbecue in South Africa. Teleport.
All right. Exactly. You know, it's funny. I had my background in Arusha earlier, and I was like, I was in my own teleportation mode, you know, honing in that. We're going to go to the cultural aspect, the cultural exchange program. This is where we get to ask our brothers and sisters from Arusha questions. And any questions that come to mind in terms of, you know, the differences of how they live there and how we live here? I know Kayla had already did some research on Arusha and her hometown in San Bernardino, looking at some comparisons and some contrasts. And so maybe, Kayla, you'll want to talk about that later. But let's ask the one question that we have is, you know, what is your favorite food out there? And so, Solomon, we would like to know what's their favorite food out there that they like to eat and how it's prepared. Solomon, can you hear me? Maya?
My favorite food is chips, chicken.
Chicken, okay.
Candy.
Candy. You like candy? What kind of candy do you like?
Chips.
Oh my gosh, you guys are speaking my language. I like is chips. Wait, what did she say?
Okay, rice and beans.
Chips and eggs.
Rice.
I definitely concur with chips. What kind of chips? I like Doritos. What kind of chips do they have out there?
Hey, Dr. Hackett and everyone, just to let you all know, when they say chips, they're actually talking about french fries. They call french fries out here chips.
Oh, okay.
Like the British.
Like fish and chips, huh?
Fish and chips, eggs and chips. They have a dish out here called, it's like where you have french fries and it's cooked inside the eggs. So you spread a little egg on top of it. Yeah, it's really nice. So I'm gonna let a few of my students in my class tell you some of their favorite foods as well.
Okay.
Chips.
Rice and bacon.
What did you say? Say it again.
Rice and bacon.
No. You. What did you say?
Rice and beans.
Oh, rice and beans. Okay.
Chips and chicken.
Oh.
Chapati. Rice and chicken.
Chapati and chicken.
Yeah, so ugali is like a type of flour, a flour dough that they eat, similar to like rice. But it's more dough. And then chapati is kind of like tortillas, but it's hot and a little bit more, I guess, breaded. So those are like the things that they're saying rice, beans, we all know what those are. Chapatis, like I said, kind of like tacos, soft tacos.
Oh, okay. And what's the main dish in Arusha? What's the Arusha dish?
What's the main dish in Arusha?
Rice and... Oh, the main dish in Arusha is rice and meat and fish.
Oh. Okay, yeah. Okay. And which one do you prepare? Are you one of the teachers?
The one I prepare.
I'm sorry?
He said, are you one of the teachers?
Yeah, I want to teach you for sure.
Are you one of the teachers?
Oh, I am Lightness. I'm the teacher of Golden Aya. I'm teaching the kids.
All right. Hey, everybody, let's say your name. What's your name?
Lightness.
Let's say hello to Lexness. Hey, how you doing?
Hello.
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 All right. Hello. So, do you guys have any questions for Lexness or the kids? Let's open it up.
Come again?
No, I'm asking those who are in the audience if they have any questions that we can open it up for questions. What's the main sport in Arusha? I think I butchered your name. Lexness?
Pira. Football.
Oh, football?
Yes.
Netball.
Baseball. You like baseball?
Basketball.
Netball is basketball. They're saying netball.
Netball. How many of you want to come to? What, say it again?
Football.
Football.
Basketball.
Basketball. All right.
Basketball.
Cricket.
Netball.
Did she say cricket and netball?
Netball.
So, okay, my next question is, how many of them want to go come to America?
Okay, how many of you want to go to America? Raise your hands. Nicholas.
And the first thing, when they get to America, what's the first thing they want to do there?
Okay, hold on. When you go to America, what's the first thing you want to do? Hold on.
To eat.
I can't
eat. To eat American.
To eat American food. Well, what's their favorite American food? You know, it's funny. I think they're pretty giggly because of the fact that we're in this space and we're talking, and they're actually talking to people that look like them.
Say that again.
We're going to help them dream big. Kayla asked a question of Solomon. Yeah. And she says, Kayla, go ahead and ask the question.
I was wondering if you guys have beaches in Arusha, because I think you guys have beaches in Tanzania and Japan. But do you guys have any close to where you guys stay? Or any?
So the all the beaches are like in Dar es Salaam, which is a little bit south from us, probably about 8 to 12 hour ride. Where we currently are, we're more inland, so there's not any beaches here. We do have like hot springs that aren't so far away that we utilize, but not beaches.
Okay, that's nice. Do you guys go to the hot springs often or not really?
Well, myself and my team, we've been there once, but we do plan on going again.
Okay, that sounds nice.
What type of field trips do you guys embark on with the kids?
We haven't done any field trips yet, but we are planning one at the end of the year, but it's a surprise.
Oh, okay. All right. Love it. I love it. Amar, she has a few of her kids right here. Say hello, kids.
Say hi. Say hi.
JJ.
What's their names, Amar?
So we have Caroline.
And hi, Caroline.
She's shy. And then we have, say your name.
Amaya.
Hi, Amaya. Hey, Amaya, let's have Amaya. Oh, go ahead.
Take the head. Come here, Jaden. Here, they're waiting on you. And Jaden.
Hi, Jaden.
Hello.
Say hi to your long lost distant relatives in Arusha. Yes, say hi to them.
Say hi.
Hi.
Say hi.
Hi.
They can see you.
You're in Africa.
Yeah.
Here in Africa. Yes, absolutely. You guys have any other questions with regards to our Arusha friends, our new virtual pen pal partners? This pilot is really to develop a virtual pen pal with some of the folks that are, you know, the same age range. And as soon as we launch that off, it'll be good because one of the things that's important for them is to learn English, right? And the more they're exposed to folks that are English speakers, the better it is that they can master the language quick. Like for example, Emily, when you went to, she said that she's half French from Belgium. When you went to Belgium, how were you able to pick up the language?
Well, I was 4 at the time, and my mom already spoke French at home, so, you know, just listening to her, and even now I still pick up words from my grandparents whenever I talk to them.
Okay.
So.
Cool. What other questions do we have?
I would like to know what type of music do they like listening to?
Solomon, did you hear that? What type of music do they like listening to? Who's their favorite musical artist?
They're being asked.
Yeah, they're being asked. What is their favorite song?
When I'm speaking,
Habiri Yako, Habiri Yako.
Alanurka song.
Habiri Yako means how are you in Swahili? Kayla said, come out, said they want to learn Swahili.
Diamond song.
Oh.
Diamond song.
Namuso.
Ariana song.
Nicki Minaj song.
Nicki Minaj.
Ray Ban song.
How do they know about Nicki Minaj?
And give us a
Zuchu song.
My room.
So yeah, Diamond is a big artist here, and then we also had someone say Nicki Minaj.
So Diamond. I'll have to look up Diamond to see the style.
Yeah, Dr. Hackett.
Yes.
Yeah, we're going to ask, our students are going to ask you guys some questions. So they're going to ask the next question.
Okay, perfect.
All right, cool.
Be ready to answer some questions from our Swahili. They wanna know, ask questions about us now. Here we go.
Do you like to come in Tanzania to visit?
I would like
yes,
to come.
I would love to come to Tanzania to visit. Yes, I want to visit
yes.
you.
Yes.
So I can give we can do high fives.
It's one of my dreams to get out to Africa one of these days, and Tanzania would be a good spot to land first, since I know I got friends out there now.
How do you say you're my friend in Swahili?
Unapenda kuja Tanzania.
Say it slower, a little slower for me.
How do you say you're my friend?
That's hard. That's
hard.
Teach them something to say.
Wewe niki rafiki yangu. Wewe ni rafiki yangu. Did I say it right? You know, you guys can jump on Google and put say a word in Swahili, and you'll be able to translate it. And they have the speaker too. So I'm gonna say it again. Are you ready? I'm gonna try it in Swahili. Wewe ni rafiki. Wewe ni rafiki. Yanu yangu. Let me hear you guys say it. Wewe ni rafiki yangu.
Wewe ni rafiki yangu.
Wewe ni rafiki yangu.
Yes. Say it, Larry.
Wewe ni rafiki yangu.
Wewe ni rafiki yangu.
Yes. Let's hear you say it, Princess. Wewe ni. Wewe ni rafiki yangu.
Wewe ni rafiki yangu.
So you're
going to
teach the kids how to say it. Say it.
I put it in the chat so you guys can see it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Can I tell you another one?
Can I tell you another one?
Yes.
Yes.
Kitty.
Kitty?
That is
Jerry.
Jerry. Jerry.
Chair.
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 Chairs. How do you say chair in a
Kitty is chair.
Kitty. Kitty is chair. Let's say everybody say that.
Kitty.
Kitty is chair. Kitty.
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 Yes, Kitty is chair.
What about bed?
How do you say bed in Swahili?
What?
Baya.
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 Baya. Leo, you got a good job over here. What does that mean? A hujambo, hujambo.
Hujambo.
And they get all giggly on that.
That's why I saw it on Google.
Yeah. Hey, come find something on Google to say in Swahili to see if, you know, if we're doing it right. Wait, ask the one kid that wears the beanies, does he have mini beanies that he wears?
Dr. Hackett, we're going to go back to them. We're in the next class now. The next one, this class is going to teach you something, and you can go back to the next one.
Okay.
Okay.
What is your favorite food?
What is your favorite food, everyone? Who wants to start?
My favorite food is spaghetti. Spaghetti tambi.
Spaghetti tambi.
Spaghetti tambi.
You
say spaghetti. Tambi means spaghetti. Tambi means spaghetti.
Tambi means spaghetti.
Oh, tambi. Tambi. Tambi means spaghetti. This is awesome. All right. What is your favorite food, guys? Emily, what's your favorite food?
Pizza.
Do you like pizza? Do you guys have pizza out there?
Tanzania. What is your first thing when you come in Tanzania?
I want to come to the school. I want to come see you guys. That would be the first thing I do.
Okay.
Did you hear that? We want to come to the school to see you guys.
I want to come and see all of you guys. What is the first thing you do if you come to Tanzania?
I'm going to come to the school. I'm gonna come see you.
I'm gonna come see you guys, and I want you to take me to your favorite restaurant.
Say it again because they didn't hear you.
I want to come see them. I'm gonna come to the school. That would be the first thing that I do. Come see y'all. I'm coming to see y'all.
What about you, Rashid, Larry, Kamal, Princess?
After we go see them, first thing when we land, the next thing I want to do is have them take us to their favorite restaurant.
I would want to try some of the local food after seeing them.
I want to learn the dances.
Yes, that would be so much fun.
I agree.
What about you, Rashid?
Yes, I agree. Like, learn the dances, just have a conversation. Learn a lifestyle, and just reconnect with our ancestor or land. You know, learn what make learn what make Africa special. You know. All right, and eat some fruit. Eat some exotic fruit. I want to try the fruit. You know.
What's the best fruit out there?
The best fruit is apple.
They have lots of apples there? What color are they? Green apples, red apples?
Red apple.
Have you been to the mountain there? What's the mountain, Kayla?
Mount Kilimanjaro.
Yes.
Yeah, Kilimanjaro.
Yes. Mount Kilimanjaro.
How far is that from you guys?
Mount Kilimanjaro.
Mount Kilimanjaro. How far is it?
How far is it from here?
It's like 2 hours. Three hours.
Wow.
What's the name?
Oh, say that again.
What's his name?
What's your name? Mm-hmm.
My name is Niza.
Niza.
Yes.
Are you having fun, Niza? Are you having fun?
Yes.
All right. Princess, if you were going to go out to Arusha, what would you first go to see? Or what would you want to know about the place?
I want to learn their culture. That's one thing I would like to do, learn their culture and how they do things different from America.
She's like, what? So what's different? What's different from America in terms of Arusha? What is different?
Are you asking me?
I'm asking the golden era. What's some of the major differences between Arusha and America?
I would say some of the differences are the culture. It's a very strong culture here that very deeply rooted in their traditions here. And then, you know, our situation in America and our lack of tradition there due to our circumstances. But I would say the outside environment is a little bit different. Here, they have some paved roads, some dirt roads. The houses are different, but they have a different array of houses. They have, anywhere from like old traditional houses to more modern houses. That's one of the differences. The people are different, more friendly, I guess, in differences in that sense, and more welcoming.
So we have about 3 minutes. Is there anything else that you guys would like to say to our Arusha friends?
How old are you?
Okay. So do I need to? How old
are the students?
Oh, the students. So they're asking how old are each of the students?
I am 21 years old.
I'm gonna have it delivered, but the patient is.
How do you say 19 in Swahili?
I'm 10 years old.
You're 10?
I am 11. I am 9 years old.
I am 8 years old.
I am 9 years old.
I am 11 years old.
I am 11 years old.
I am 12 years old.
I am 12 years old.
How do you say 19 in Swahili?
I'm 6.
Nineteen is Kuminatisa.
Okay.
Say that again.
Kuminatisa.
Kuminatisa. Okay.
Kumonatista. Let's all say that. We're learning. Kumonatista.
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 I am 10 years old.
I am 8 years old.
I am 12 years old.
I am 8 years old.
I am 8 years old.
I am 11 years old.
I am 9 years old.
I am 9 years old.
I am 11 years old.
I am 12 years old.
Saba.
All right, well, we're at 8 o'clock now, so I do want to say that this has been a wonderful experience to begin with as our pilot. I did find a word to say that we'll see you later. Tutakuano bade. Tutakuano bade. Did I pronounce that right?
I just realized.
Oh, you're on mute. I can't hear you.
Tutaonana badai.
Badai. Tutakuana badai. That means we will see you later.
Tutaonana.
Tutakuana. Koana. Tutakuana.
Tutaonana.
Oh. Tutakuana.
Tutaonana.
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 Bye. That means I will see you later.
Yes. Tutaonana badai. Badai is later.
Oh, okay. Tutakuonana. Tutakuana. Bye. Die. I want everybody to say that.
That's
it.
Tuta banana badaya. Tuta banana badaya.
Tuta banana badaya.
Good.
Tuta banana badaya.
Good.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to meet you. I can't wait till our next Saturday in Richmond, where, you know, we'll look at some other things. I know the first one was a little long, but we'll make sure we do it in segments so that we can continue to learn about Arusha, and you guys learn about America and learn English and learn learn the language in Arusha. This is going to be a great endeavor. This is only the beginning. I do want to thank all of the participants in this call. You guys have been great. Solomon, I love what you guys are doing. You and Azana and now, obviously Maya, but now we met one of the other teachers to teach us some of these Swahili terms. And so this will be good. Is there any lasting comments? I want to thank Leo and provided his book and you guys are reading it. I think it's important for us to continue to read aloud in terms of for literacy purposes. But I do want to thank you. And I want to thank everybody that's been out here.
Well, they can tell them on here.
So lasting comments.
I just want to say real quickly, I think everyone participating today, this is very inspiring, very enriching. And I want to thank also Quincy Hetzel, who spoke in the video, and his friend Caleb. These young men are doing incredible things. So thank you all.
Also just want to say thank you so much for everybody coming out and everybody speaking their opinions and just getting a feel for everybody and the feel of Arusha. Like, I can feel the energy through the phone. So I'm just excited to keep on excelling with you guys, especially with this. So I'm really inspired. Like my colleague said, I'm really inspired. So I appreciate you guys taking the time. So thank you guys so much.
I just want to say, can you hear me, Princess? Can Princess hear me?
Thank you so much.
Any more lasting comments? Leo, you were saying if Princess can hear you.
Yeah, Princess, here's a book for you because you were talking about invisibility. This may be a good book for you to read, The Invisible Man.
Thank you. Where can I find that at?
On Amazon.
Okay, thank you.
I think you may relate to it, so I wanted to share this with you.
Final comments.
Yeah, I just wanted to show you all a little bit about what we see out here. So this is, you know, daytime. People hanging out on the block. This is where our school is here.
Yeah, I think now we can see the picture. The bandwidth was kind of off, but okay, wow. No, okay, now you just came back into picture, Solomon. One of the things that I do want to do is bring some more technology to get this Wi-Fi going. That would be good to have a tower or something in that area.
All right, can you all see now?
Yes.
So this is basically a border of the street that we're on. This is our school here, our Garvey class, Kwame class, and Ida B. Wells. And this is how beautiful Arusha is. So you all are so welcome. Thank you all for participating. Our students love you and they really enjoyed the experience.
Thank you, Solomon. Continue doing what you do, man. I appreciate you. You know, Leo and I for sure will be out there soon.
Yeah, we're coming.
Hoping to bring some of our students as well.
Well, that would be amazing for sure.
So we're going to continue this momentum. We're going to continue to invent the future and think big, and dream awake. You guys have a blessed rest of your morning and the rest of your afternoon, Solomon, in Arusha, but the rest of our morning. We're 8 o'clock and you guys are up and at them. Thank you for getting up. It's a big ask to start dialoguing at 5:30 in the morning, but you know, Solomon does it all the time when he's on the call with Leo and I and others when we're dealing with this. So thank you guys, and we will see you next time. And again, Tutak Oana Badai. Let's say everybody say that.
Tutu
Onana Badai.
Tutu Onana Badai.
Tutu Unana Badai.
Tutu. That means see you.
All right. Love you guys. You guys take care. We'll see you next time. See you later, Maya. Thank you so much. Izana, see you later, my buddy. Take care. We'll see you next time.
Yes. Everybody have a blessed weekend. Love you, Solomon.
All right. Take care. Enjoy your weekend. Yes, sir.
Let me give that Hail Atlantis salute. Hail Atlantis.
Hail Atlantis.
Thank you, Emily Hail Rose, Atlantis. For participating.
I'm going to call you in 5 minutes.
Okay, love you.
Love you.